can Shockwave therapy help men who have erectile dysfunction after, say, prostate cancer surgery? Is there good evidence for it?
Well, I'm going to share a story with you. I produced my research for Peyronie's disease that showed that with therapeutic ultrasound, 70% of men would improve, but 30% didn't. And this was because they had calcifications in their penile tissues, which meant the ultrasound could not penetrate that. So I was asked to do a review of applying shockwave therapy. It's called focal low intensity shockwave therapy for these Peyronie's patients that didn't improve. And to my surprise, many of them did improve. And I would say 70% of them got good outcomes. And along with that, a great improvement in erectile function. It was like a side effect that I didn't expect. Now, I use a machine called the Stores, which is of the second generation. So there's two types of shockwave. One is called radial shockwave and one is called focus shockwave. So second generation or the newer technology is focal shockwave. So it's really important that we start off by talking about in urology and in erectile dysfunction, we're only talking about focal shockwave for the body work that I do. Now, it just so happened that this machine, it's quite expensive to buy. So I asked a number of patients while I was trialing the machine who'd undergone radical prostatectomy if they wouldn't mind being guinea pigs for me, because the body of evidence was not conclusive and was only emerging. So to my surprise, the first couple of people that I actually used as guinea pigs reported beyond words improvement. The very first patient, having had not one erection for 3.5 years after his radical prostatectomy, to right in front of my eyes within about 15 seconds of a full erection. It was like we rebooted the system. So the nerves that wrap around the prostate are called the cavernosal nerves, and those nerves are basically bruised during surgery. We often talk about it being a 1 to 2 year recovery time. So we want to try and understand that if we have nerve tissue damage, it's like an electrical pathway or circuit that's shut down for a while. And what I feel the role of is in post-prostatectomy erectile dysfunction is trying to reboot or challenge those nerves to wake back up again quicker than they might naturally do. So we talk about nerve recovery being healing at about 1 millimeter per month, very, very, very slow. So most guys understand they're going to be impotent initially, but they often think it's only going to be for 3 months. But it's more likely on average to be 2 years, and only sort of 30 to 50% of men get their sexual function back after 2 years as well. So there's a very big gap in what we can do in that time. We have strategies like penile injections, but most men just want to have normal function back. So I started doing case studies in my clinical practice. I started looking at guys early post-prostatectomy, around 3 months post-prostatectomy, once they'd had their PSA results cleared. I didn't find that I was getting very much response. Then I started looking at guys 6 months post-radical prostatectomy, and these were guys who had no function. And I started to see things emerging. But if I actually got the guys seemingly after 8 or 9 months to 2 years, that body of patients tended to get the fastest responses. So at the moment, there is a lot of excitement around this, but I honestly feel that we move faster in clinic than we do in research. So I've been looking out for these papers to publish the findings that are using the shockwave therapy in the post-operative prostatectomy patients. My feeling is they're going to probably pitch it too soon and that the results aren't really going to be very promising. Because I played around that with my clinic, and I even tried to do that in my PhD to show that if we did pelvic floor exercise training at a high intensity, that those guys after 3 months of training versus those who had less intensive training would get much better erectile function scores, which they did not. And that's because of this period of time with neuropraxia for the first 3 or 4 months, that the nerves just shut down and they bruise. It's a normal pathological process. So does focal shockwave work for erectile dysfunction? Well, I wasn't sure what to do because this machine was going to cost me $40,000. So I got many, many guinea pigs in to help me until I couldn't unsee what was happening. And that was men were reporting
really improved outcomes. And so we purchased the machine and I probably provide 10 to 15 sessions a day now for not only erectile dysfunction, but Peyronie's disease and a number of other things. So basically it just works by trying to agitate the tissue to try and create, it's what we call a pro-inflammatory effect. So when we have tissue that's not free flowing or a bit dense, as in Peyronie's disease, or when the nerves are inflamed or not conducting the message properly, that we agitate the area enough for it to create a process of angiogenesis, lays down new microcellular tissues and helps provide and stimulate better blood flow to the area. So in our machine, it talks about protocols of about 6 sessions of requirement to improve erectile dysfunction generally. This may be the case for things like vascular erectile dysfunction for people like diabetic patients, but I really feel it's more like a 10 to 15 session for the post-proctectomy patients. So I provide the treatment and I don't even promote that I do it. It's a lot of it's word of mouth from one patient to another, but I even have a physio himself who's been working for me now for the last 6 months. He's very dedicated to applying this machine because he himself has been through bowel cancer and ended up with erectile dysfunction and Peyronie's disease. And he's very impressed with the improvements in those things for himself. So he's become my main deliverer of the shockwave therapy in our clinic. And it's just based on an opportunity to apply things to willing patients to try and iron out where it was going to be most effective. I'll also say now I feel much more comfortable with starting the shockwave therapy at around the 6-month mark as my go-to point. I like to make sure that men have had 2, not 1, but 2 PSA blood tests that have cleared them of any prostate cancer cells before we start the shockwave. Because we just want to make sure that we have good oncological clearance and that we're not, you know, firing things up that potentially might progress. Because when we do these sorts of treatments, the contraindications is always whether or not there's any cancer cells in the area. So I think it's something that we shouldn't jump in too soon with. Evidence may change that as time goes by, but from what I've observed, it's going to be more helpful in that second part of the first year and beyond.
You mentioned that there are quite a few sessions. I'm wondering what the cost and the time involved is for this particular treatment.
Well, the cost is going to be variable to each clinic. Mm-hmm. Potentially the costs are around about $150 to $200 per session, and the health fund rebates will apply for that. Then you can also get the healthcare plans, and the healthcare plans provide, in Australia anyway, are funded for a session for about 5 sessions over 1 year. But for most men, if they're not feeling like they're getting any sign of result after about 6 sessions, well, I often say to them, let's just leave it for about 3 months and we'll review things. And actually often in that time, things have started to awaken up naturally. So it's a potential assister. So I think we have to do basically individualized treatment planning. There's probably no point in having under 6 sessions. So if you don't think you can afford it, I'd say, you know, having 3 or 4 sessions is really not going to be enough to assess whether or not there's going to be any change.
And at the moment, there's no sort of a home machine that somebody can invest in themselves. It's something they have to find a clinic that specifically does this and go to them.
Yeah. So there's a, particularly in America and the States, there's a lot more availability of the focal shockwave machines. There's a couple of physiotherapists, probably one in each state now, I think, who are accessing that. And then you've got some men's health specialists and urologists that are also using the focal shockwave machine in Australia. But certainly I can think of at least one person in each state now who's, as a physiotherapy, providing this treatment. As an aside, I'll also just mention that many of my patients who had persistent erectile dysfunction after they had a prostatectomy have reported to me that coincidentally, their urinary incontinence improved. And I have to say that I feel that there is quite an alliance with continence recovery and nerve recovery in a good number of our patients. So I now provide the Shockwave therapy for persistent urinary leakage, and I'm yet to find someone that hasn't helped. The machine itself doesn't even have protocols for that, but the pathway, the nervous pathway for both continence and sexual function is the same as the S234 pudendal artery, which also supplies the pelvic floor. So I always say it's a 2-for-1 with pelvic floor training, both sexual function and continence, even bowel continence. So we're getting an opportunity to see surprising and unexpected resolution of urinary incontinence as well.
Wonderful. I mean, that in a way it makes sense. Everything ends up being very interlinked. It's going to be fascinating with the sounds of it when more research is published, whether Shockwave therapy is going to become more of a standardized part of rehabilitation from the sounds of it for both erectile function and continence.
And papers have already emerged to show that it's working in women. So for like things like overactive bladder or stress urinary incontinence. And a lot of times studies start off in women, but can be translated to men. And that's what I'm doing in my clinic too.
Wonderful. And thank you so much, Jo. I wonder, is there anything else you'd love to add about Shockwave therapy before we close?
Just with Shockwave therapy, because it is very new, just be careful that you don't get dismissed as it being some fad thing. Also be aware that people might charge a lot of money for it. And if you are concerned about those costs, because you could be charged up to $500 per session, just keep doing your homework on what's a more realistic option. We know there's a very potentially vulnerable population here. So it's just, I prefer to have a lower price point and have more treatment so that men can get more benefit than having, you know, 3 or 4 treatments that are very high effect. So a very high cost with less effects. So you just have to do your homework and make sure that you're not sort of getting yourself into financial distress over this as well.
Absolutely. And I think, did you mention earlier that within Australia, there's a healthcare plan that somebody could get that would reduce the cost significantly? So I'm wondering in my mind, is the first step for somebody who's interested, the GP's office, to talk to them about a healthcare plan to do with this?
Yeah. So the healthcare plan is listed by your GP. And you simply just need to be seen by a specialist. So everyone who's had prostate cancer surgery, for example, have had a urologist. And then someone like me, a healthcare provider, allied health, can provide these 5 funded sessions that are partially funded. They do go a long way to helping make it a realistic option